A rather special piece of music comes up for sale at a rock legends auction tonight. It's a previously undiscovered recording of Mick Jagger and John Lennon performing together. According to the Cooper Owen Galleries, who are doing the sale, that's what it is. Here's a sample of it. Well, there we are. Does that sound like Lennon and Jagger to you? Let's ask people who know about these things. Rick Sky, music journalist, Hunter Davies, Beatles biographer. Rick Sky, can you prove it?
Well, it's very hard to prove these things, but it does seem very genuine. Jagger himself is said to have authenticated this. He said, yeah, this jam did happen with John in 1974, and it's valid, yeah.
And is it good?
It's good for a jam. I mean, it's not going to set the world alight. But I mean, what's interesting about it is that it's a curio. I mean, there are very, very few occasions when Lennon and Jagger got together. I mean, they have played together before, but this is pretty rare.
What do you reckon, Hunter Davies?
I don't know how you can prove that it's Lennon. That was Mick Jagger singing and Lennon on guitar. I don't know. What's strange about it is that I travelled with Mick Jagger and John Lennon for a day in 1968. We were going to Bangor in North Wales. You know that is, John, don't you?
Ah, very well.
Well, we were going to see Maharishi. It was an amazing weekend because it was the weekend we heard that Brian Epstein had died. On the train, by chance, the roadies weren't there and the wives weren't there. They missed the train. And I was with Mick Jagger and the Beatles. And there was, all the way through, I'd noticed a certain coldness, a distance, a stiffness between them. And I thought, are they friends? Do they hate each other? But they're perfectly polite. A few days later, I was with John. I said, what's the relationship with Mick? You did seem a bit remote from him. Are you jealous of his music or his success from coming along? He said, oh, no, with no competition with the music. We don't feel rivals. The only thing I'm jealous about is his looks. I wanted to look like that. I didn't want to wear a little suit on stage. So I said, but really, if you think about it, you looked upon as fairly scruffy with your long hair when you first arrived. So in some senses, you paved the way. I've got the plumber in here. Can you hear the plumber? You paved the way for the Rolling Stones. So you begat the Rolling Stones. They were friendly, though.
Were they?
So this is an interesting... it's a freak of nature.
when he said envious of his looks, I thought he meant he wanted big fat lips as well.
Sorry, I missed that, John.
I said, Lennon said he was envious of his looks, I thought you meant that Lennon wanted big fat lips as well.
He was envious of when the Rolling Stones came along, they all wore scruffy, we all thought at that time, clothes on stage, and they weren't uniform or neatly dressed the way the Beatles were.
But wasn't he a bit cold anyway, Lennon? That's the impression, no?
No, not at all. Very warm. He could be very fiery. He could be very up and down. He could be very remote. And I used to go and see him in his swimming pool at Weybridge. I'd swim around for 3 hours and he wouldn't speak at all. And I'd come back into the house, he wouldn't be speaking. He was either stoned or off with the fairies. I'd come back another day, it'd be absolutely brilliant.
So the importance of this bit of music then, as you say,
not important, just interesting and amusing, yes.
And you'd agree with that, Rick Sky?
I think so, yeah. It's not an important piece of music. It's just a good curio, you know. And, I mean, it's nice to have... I mean, the Beatles and the Rolling Stones were the two two most important bands of all time. So any piece that's got two members on it is well worth hearing and well worth keeping.
Do you agree with that, 100 most important bands of all time?
Oh, certainly. Well, the Beatles definitely were. I'm not really such a fan of the Rolling Stones. But what's happening to the Beatles, and it's a sort of indication of how lousy popular music is today, there seems to be a story like this every day. Undiscovered photographs, undiscovered tapes, new things that are all fairly trivial. The thing is that the further we get from the Beatles, and they haven't played for 40 years, odd, the bigger they become.
40 years on, make you feel old, doesn't it? That's true, isn't it? And will there be any bands playing today that we'll be talking about on the Today programme in 40 years' time?
I wouldn't have thought so. Not currently playing. I would hope there would be. I would like a new group to come along that's clever and creative and musically inspired, who give us 150 songs we'll sing forever, as the Beatles did, but I can't see it happening.
Rick, Sky, can you?
I think rock music, British rock music, is in its worst state for a long, long time. You know, you've only got to look at the bands around nowadays to realise they're not going to be around in 40 years' time. If anything, the best music is now coming out of the black R&B and rap scene or the dance scene, but you know, in terms of competing with the Beatles or the Stones, no one holds a candle to them.
So what's gone wrong, Hunter? Is it maybe all this, these manufactured bands and all that stuff?
No, apart from lack of talent, that's lack of talent and other things, these things going cycles, the pendulum swings one way or the other. I think the main reason is that popular music has become diffused. It's split up. Mm. There are so many variations of it. I don't know. All those words that bloke just used there about rap and R&B, I don't know what they are. All that stuff. When the Beatles were around, there only was sort of rock and roll, or it was all really popular music, so you knew where you were, and it appealed mainly to the same sort of people. Now it's all split up and disappearing of its own...
Right, hole in the centre of the record.
That's right.
Got it. Gentlemen, Hunter Davies, Rick Sky, thank you both very much indeed.